I'm done with that.
Do you feel like the world is your oyster again? Has this been all like a...
special. Well, it is an interesting process that when you're not part of it, you observe it from a distance, and it happens. And if there's someone, a performance that you like or a movie that you like that is nominated, you're genuinely sort of happy, and you think, oh, great, you know, they got it right, or you know, hope he wins or hope she wins. Mm-hmm. And then you live your life. When you're in the whirlwind of it, it's a totally different experience. It's like the whole world knows, you know. I didn't realize what a big deal it was. Is that maybe that's maybe other people have said that, I don't know, but it's quite bizarre and wonderful. I mean, mm-hmm. who you know, my life is, it's right now at the moment, it's a fairy tale, you know.
Does it feel different as an actor at all? Do you feel, I mean, you've been through, you're kind of the veteran of the five nominees and Best Actor. You're kind of the senior, you're not, there, I think somebody else is as old as you at least, but it's not.
I think I've got 3 years on George.
Yes, but you have a career. Your career is more loaded, I think, with iconic performances that people remember from 25 years ago than George or Brad or Damien,
yeah.
Damien obviously. Does that, have things changed? Do you feel like you're waiting, you're into the next round of your acting life, or is it a continuum?
That remains to be seen, really. I think I am technically out of work at the moment, and I mean, then that's something that you it's a sea you swim in, you know. I'm very used to that, and that to me is it amuses me that one is nominated for an Oscar and I'm out of work, you know, but yeah. I can't go and wait a table, can I? You know, it would not right now, anyway. Yeah. Wouldn't be the best time to.
When I said the studio would prefer you not be working,
yeah,
this month.
Working at the newsroom.
Yeah. Or even a movie, just having your body here.
Yeah, they
helpful.
Like the fact that I'm, it helps that one is available for the, I feed the machine.
It is a bit of a machine. It's a very strange phenomenon. But do you? So,
I'm enjoying it though. I think you've got to. You have to embrace it and surrender to it, and enjoy it. I think you have to remember to enjoy it.
When you took on Smiley, did you think 2 years from now, or a year and a half from now, or whenever it was, that you're gonna be going through some sort of process like this, or could be going through, was it even a consideration for
you? No, not really. No, because we you know, the movie doesn't really, it's a piece unto itself, and you have a director, Thomas Alfredson, Swedish director, did Let the Right One In. There's a certain frequency to the movie, a certain pace to it. Reading the script, you knew Tinker was very faithful to the era and the book. Mm-hmm. It did not pander to that sort of Bond-born thing. Mm-hmm. You never really ever know how it's going to be received, because they're also, it follows a television series back in the late 70s, mm. which was hugely successful. So you never know how it's going to be perceived, how it's critically going to be perceived. And also the component is always, is there an audience for it? That is always the you know, we were patting ourselves on the back on the Thursday night with a clutching a handful of wonderful reviews, mm-hmm. knowing the movie was going to open the next day, not knowing if it would make $1 or $10 or $100. I mean, mm-hmm. you never really know. So there are a lot of questions to it, and that it's been received as well as been received, and has gone the distance, had the legs at the box office, and we got 11 BAFTA nominations, and it's you hope that for a movie, but it's not something you consciously are thinking about. And I've also been told, I'm a little not cynical, but I'm hardened to that. You know, that you'll be nominated for this, or this is your moment, or mm-hmm. you know, I've heard that before.
And not fun to not have it happen, I guess.
It's that thing of I'll believe it when you know. Now it's I'll believe it when I see it.
So do you carry with you any of the, I mean, obviously not Academy Awards, but do you carry with you the characters that people are so obsessed with over all these years? I mean, it's funny that you and Brad Pitt were both in True Romance, and yeah. characters that are amongst the highlights of both of your careers. People yeah. still talk about his performance and your performance in that movie. Obviously, no awards for that movie, but has this following that's very passionate and still remembers, you know, those moments.
I mean, for me, a lot of it is it's cold coffee. Mm-hmm. I mean, obviously, I look back and there are things that I have favorites, I guess, and that being one of them, the True Romance. But it's old work, and it's like, I don't know, it's like coming out with an album. It's like having Sgt. Pepper mm-hmm. and someone saying, you know, all they want to hear is Love Me Do. I'm not comparing myself to the genius of the Beatles, of course, but it's
that. And they compare themselves to Jesus, and therefore
yeah, but,
you're not comparing yourself to Jesus.
Not, like yeah, yes. That's you know, it's that sort of you know, people say to me, sometimes it feels that I haven't really, in the intervening years since Sid and Nancy, haven't done anything, you know, because people always say to me, a lot of people say, you know, loved you in Sid and Nancy. Maybe I should have just stopped there.
That's a long time ago, and a lot of great performances in between.
Yeah, but you still hear that a lot. Yeah.
So everybody has their own time capsules, and
yeah, and they like their, they have their favorites, and you have your subjective view about stuff,
right?
Because you remember making the movie, or whether it was a good experience, a bad experience, what was happening in your life at the time, how old you were. You know, did I enjoy the location? Did I get on with the people that I was working with? I mean, there's all of those things that I bring to it, mm-hmm. and obviously for other people, it's just an experience in the cinema, and so I sometimes feel I have to be a little bit more patient, mm-hmm. You know, that I can't. It's if someone presents me with a you know, that picture of me as Sid Vicious leaning against that yellow poster, I have to remember that they're fans of the movie, but I can't bring my baggage to it, you know.
So are you always looking for the next Sergeant Pepper for you, or a role that is potentially got that kind of excitement to it? Is that really what gets you going, or you just want to be jobbing actor, or?
Yeah, I mean, they tend to find me. I mean, Smiley, it fell from the sky. I was, in my kitchen, you know, and, the phone rang, and they said that they said, "Would you, you know, they're making Tinker Tailor Soldier Spy, and they want you to play Smiley," and that's the amazing thing about this. That's the amazing thing about this job, is that you can be out of work, and literally, the phone rings, and your life changes. And you know, there I was in my kitchen a couple of years back, you know, out of work, you know, on the computer drinking my coffee, and here I am.
So is that the same actor's lament of ever, that the next job is never going to show up, and until the phone rings, oh my God?
Yeah, I mean, it's something I get. I don't panic anymore. Mm-hmm. You know, you. It is something that you get used to. And for some, it would be that feeling would be terrifying. But they come and they find me, and you know, True Romance was. I met with Tony, and he told me the description of the character. I hadn't even read the script, mm-hmm. and I said, "I'll do it." There's one I chased, actually, was with the other Scott brother, Ridley, mm-hmm. and I heard that they were making Hannibal, and I enjoyed the first movie so much, and I had not worked with Ridley, and I admired him for many years, and I called him and said, I hear that you still haven't found a Mason Verger. Mm-hmm. And I've read the book, and I wouldn't mind having a go at him. Mm-hmm. And we had a very sort of friendly conversation, which ended with him saying, "Well, look, you know, my people call your people, and we'll see if we can work something out." And I called my agent, and I said, "I think Ridley Scott has just offered me the role over the phone. I'm not sure, but he says he will call you." And he did. But that was a one-off. I'd never done that before. But I got, you know, it's that thing of, can I speak to Ridley Scott? And you actually get, and you get through to him. You go, oh. So that was, but they just find me.
Do you have a list of directors who you really like to work with, who you haven't, or that you would like to work with again? Or is it kind of the material first?
It's both, really. Let me think. Well, I've never worked with Scorsese. That would be a nice. I mean,
I don't know. Did Scorsese light with you? I guess.
Yes, he did. he and that's another a film I'm proud of. But yeah, I've never worked with Marty, and that may, or who knows? You know, he may not like me as an actor. I mean, there are people that there are people out there that there's studios that I've never worked for. Mm-hmm. I've been the lucky mascot golden boy, I guess, for Warner's, mm-hmm. and then Sony. I mean, we had huge successes. Nearly everything I'd been in with them, mm-hmm. I don't think I've made anything for Paramount. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, Cronenberg won't hear my name. You know, just says.
Really?
Yeah. And
you would seem to fit right in with that group.
I don't know, but anyway, but there are people that so maybe. I don't know. Either Scorsese doesn't like my work, or, you know, I mean, I did live with his, with his ex-wife for a while, but it wasn't, you know,
they
didn't overlap. No, maybe he feels a little weird there.
So does How the Phone Ring change with Commissioner Gordon, or, you know, those kind of roles. You, this is a quieter Gary Oldman in the last 5 years than we recall.
Yeah. Well, yeah. I mean, I'm hoping to... what am I looking for? I mean, I've done comedy, and certainly before movies, you know, I played comedy on the stage. Mm-hmm. That would be nice. That would be a good phone call.
Looking. Well, it's funny because Max von Sydow actually said the same thing.
Yeah.
He says the one thing he did on stage, he had done the comedy on stage, but nobody really thinks of him that way in films.
Well, you,
and he would love to do it.
Yeah, you can get a little, you know, you go through these, you do go through these periods where you're typecast. Mm-hmm. And people think sometimes that you're offered everything. Mm-hmm. And you're not. So, you know, it's a mix. My career has been, I've worked out of necessity. I've worked on things that I would have preferred not to work on. Mm-hmm. But I need to, you've got to live in the real world, and you have kids and responsibility and paying bills like everybody else.
I think people forget that's reality. I mean, if people see somebody directed a movie or acted in a movie or a few movies, and they kind of assume they're set for life somehow, like they got a signing bonus and...
Yeah, and the people, you know, they think that you... I mean, I know that there are people out there that are multi-millionaires and have, you know, funny is money. You know, a lot of those comedians have made a fortune and probably, you know, needn't work again. Mm-hmm. You know, there was that golden time. There was the Michael Douglas, you know, Michael Douglas and, mm-hmm. and Bruce Willis, where, you know, I mean, you hear the numbers of Shrek, you know, mm-hmm. where you know, Myers and Diaz got, you know, they got 50 million for voiceovers.
I mean, voiceover.
It is mind-boggling. There have been people that have made a great deal of money from it, but you've got to. I've earned a nice living as an actor, but I'm not in that league. So you do. I think you've got to. When you're young, when I was 20, and I was not a care in the world, it can. I just had such a fixity of purpose, and I wouldn't compromise and but you can afford to when you don't have those other responsibilities. When you're a grown up and you're in the real world, you've got to, you know. So it's taken me. I've not always been completely in control of the reins, mm-hmm. of the career. And occasionally there have been times when I can direct it and steer it. And you engineer it to a point, and then you're at the mercy of the material, what they're making, the imagination of the people that are casting you. Mm-hmm. You know, there are all those variables that you're dealing with.
And do you ever have the urge these days to do other things, to go directing? And
well, I've just finished. I kept busy over the last 15 years or whatever it is since I directed, and I've just finished something, and I hope to be doing that in 2013, and get behind the camera.
You get the money together, and
I'm out looking for some money.
Because it's interesting, you did your movie and Tim Roth's movie were both extremely powerful, extremely intense, and then neither one of you directed again. It was kind of like a little bit of a loss for a lot of us.
Yeah, it's odd. I followed up with with Nil by Mouth, with a script that actually the first draft of it has 97 on it, about a sex addict, and in a relationship with the wife and a mistress, and it was even then it was too back then it was people with the same honesty,
right,
written with the same sort of rawness, and I think it was very close to the bone for people, and I couldn't raise a nickel, and oddly I met up with Steve McQueen, and I asked him, I said, why did you set your movie in New York? And he said, because I couldn't raise any money for it in the UK, because no one wanted to sort of touch it. So it still has that, it still has a sort of stigma to it. It's a subject people are very scared of.
Well, as we've seen, Mr. Fassbender has not joined you in the ranks of the nominated this year.
No.
Which is an amazing performance, and kind of, I mean, it'll have its life, I guess, but not that way.
It's been a very unusual year for awards, or who is, you know, you've got the, I mean, we got 11 nominations for BAFTA. We didn't get a single one for the Golden Globes, nothing at SAG, you know, but some people got SAG, some people got this, Critics Broadcasting Association, this was, you know, Clooney won over here, and Brad picked up one here, and I think Leonardo, isn't it that you can feel
it narrows in.
It's kind of, and yeah. I think in a couple of weeks, or it could be anyone's game, couldn't it?
Yeah, it's been a small group of films and people in each of the categories, and it's all kind of stayed within that group. It hasn't been, nothing's been shocking, I guess. Damien Bashir, a bit surprising for people, but only because the movie didn't do a lot of business. But ultimately, it keeps on coming up different ways. You don't quite know which way the wheel's going to spin, the way it's going this year. But good movies, at least.
But yes, and it's nice to have made the top five.
Yeah. So, are you happy to be of this moment that you can start to think about doing Lear and adults, seniors, people at this point? Or are you gonna?
Yeah. No, I am. Yeah, that's the phone call right now. This is the phone call that could change my life.
And stop. The phone stopped ringing.
Oh, they must have. They went down the list and they went, no, not him. The other guy.
Wrong number.
Yeah.
It was your call to be in Spider-Man. As Spider-Man.
I think my days of.
Spandex?
Yes, yeah, so. I don't do spandex anymore. Now I'm an artiste. It'd be nice to, you do start to look there. You I'm always flirting with going back on stage. I love the theatre. And I haven't been in a play for a number of years now, but I'm always sort of looking, and just flirting with the idea of maybe doing a play, and now as one gets older, you start to look at, you know, you've had your chance to, you know, you either play Hamlet or you miss the boat, and you start to look. Then it's Claudius and Polonius and Lear and those as you start to head there.
So it's interesting. I think it's fascinating because your energy has always been so much a draw to your work. The intensity which you can bring to, I mean, and I think in Smiley it's true also, is that it's all wrapped up very tightly, yeah. but it's there. That bringing it to these famous, these great characters that exist is an interesting challenge. Interesting for us.
Yeah, to watch I mean, you know, the mountain that one had to climb. Funny, we you know, you talk about the phone ringing, and it can. And you know, and it can change your life, and it often the phone call is the best bit of it, because if you get the phone call that says they want you to play Hamlet or Smiley, let's say they want you to play Joe Smiley, you go, really? Wow, you know, it's. Yeah, you know, I hadn't even read the script, but I knew the book, I knew the series. I said, wow, Joe Smiley, that's terrific. You know, so that call comes, and you put the phone down, and you go, wow, I'm playing George Smiley. And then you go, shit, I'm playing George Smiley. And then the work has to start. Mm-hmm. So that's the great. It's always the great moment. The actor getting the phone call saying they want, I'm playing Hamlet. Great, you know. And you put and go, shit, I'm playing now. I'm playing Hamlet. I've said yes. And this was, it was double jeopardy, really, in a way, because you had had someone who was so famous and so revered and so bloody good. Climb the mountain and reach the peak, and Guinness was the face of Smiley up all these years, mm-hmm. and other people had played him, but not as successfully, and definitively, really, as mm-hmm. for many. So that was very challenging.
And has the work itself changed for you over the years? Does that work you do after the phone is rung and you said yes, the place you have to go, the things you have to do?
No. It still requires, it still has, the work is involved. The mind starts to, you know, You are less, you're less present when you're working on a character. Mm-hmm. I think when you found a character, you can switch him off, and that you can do a day's work as George, and come home and be present and be with your kids and relax and watch soccer or whatever you do. Mm-hmm. The building of the making of George mm-hmm. is very consuming. It is all consuming, and I love the process and dread it at the same time.
And what's the part that makes you happiest? Is it having done it, or is it the work when you're on that stage or that set and it's happening?
When this is rolling, yeah, because. It is. You have to do the. You have to have a base. You have to do the work, and that's a given. Mm-hmm. But things happen in the moment when the camera's rolling, and that you can't research. Mm-hmm. Really, you can't rehearse it. Mm-hmm. You get very little rehearsal anyway, so you're sort of rehearsing, you're finding it on film in the moment of doing it. And with Tinker you get two takes, get three if you're lucky, and then I would always hear Thomas would he would be very close to the set, but sometimes it didn't permit him, you know, everyone being in it, because it was small. So the camera would be here, but Thomas would just be around the corner there, at the sort of half an eye on me through the door and the monitor. And I would always hear that sound. Cut! And I knew that was a print. And I would sometimes dread that sound because it meant moving on. Mm. And I'd go, can I have one more? One more.
And is that a Tomas thing or a budget thing?
It's a Tomas thing and a budget thing. It was both. Yeah, mm. we had to move along. That's what's changed. Mm. Yeah.
Nobody has the time anymore.
Yeah, and the things they have a process, and it is there for a reason. Mm. You know, and when you you reduce the number of days mm-hmm. working on something, then you're reducing, you're shortchanging, I think, that process. Mm. And you get less goes at it. And that's I've had to adjust to. That they're not making, that there aren't the days anymore. When I made Neil by Mouth, I had 4 weeks rehearsal. Mm. I rehearsed on location with all the props and all the, and I had 55 days to shoot. Because it was a performance piece, it's a character piece, mm-hmm. and I shot 500,000 feet of film, mm. 16, Super 16. And, that was just the way I wanted, you know, mm-hmm. if it had been 20 days, mm-hmm. you know, I wouldn't have made the film. Mm. There's no, because I could do that being an actor.
Right. Well, we were just at Sundance, and it was all 16 days to 22 days. I mean, almost every single film, no matter how complex or simple, it seemed to be that was the entire range they all had.
And were they all good?
No. That was for sure.
You know.
Some of them were, though, surprisingly. For
No, but there's going to be...
James Marsh, I think, in 22 days got
you know,
a pretty good film.
I mean, but it can't be a thing you measure things by. Yeah. If you make a movie, and whether you make it in 10 days or you make it in 110 days, when you project it onto a screen and the lights go down, you are in the arena with all the other people that have ever projected a movie and the lights went down on. So you are there with Kubrick and Kurosawa and all those people. And you will be judged. Hmm. And... people like a Coppola, a Polanski, Scorsese. You know, they don't come along every week. So you know, this with the age of a digital camera, you know, everybody can be a director. And you're going to have to sit through. You're going to have to sit through a lot of shit, and then there'll be that. There'll be that one where you go, you know, I don't know who this guy is, who did Beginners,
Mike Mills,
and I'm not familiar with what he did before.
He's really an artist more than he is a filmmaker.
But,
yeah.
But it was so refreshing. I thought, I just like the ear he has, the voice, and I thought there were just terrific things about that was one that made me, you know, I sit up. I went. It had a sort of early Woody Allen kind of charm to it, and I thought it was and beautifully acted.
Yeah, it's nice when they're. Love it when you can really fall in love. It's a rare thing.
Yeah, and it's just I like watching good acting. I like watching. I want the best for people. I'm not cynical and sit there and think, you know, well, okay, come and show me, and, you know, and I want to be open and really and be surprised and moved and all of those things. And it's great when that, it's great when something, some a person's work that you don't know, and they surprise you.
Yeah. Well, we know your work pretty well, and you've been doing that for 25 years now.
Yeah, 25. 33 years as an actor, yeah.
You're not getting even tired.
Yeah, up and down. You go up and down. It's a long time to do something, a long time to do one thing. But if I get this movie off the ground, then I can maybe get in the directing chair next year, and it'll feeds one another. It'll give me renewed, you know, give me a bit like a blood transfusion. Hmm. Yeah.
Thank you so much.
You are welcome.